Hi everyone. Shown here in this small clip is actually the moments before the collapse of the famous Tacoma Narrows Bridge in North America. And one of the reasons attributed for the collapse of the bridge was a phenomenon called resonance. At that time, this was widely accepted theory at that time, but later it was disproved. But still, even for explaining the concept of resonance, it's a commonly used example. Now here, you can see moments later, the bridge actually starts to collapse. Okay, so at that time, one of the popular reasons given for this was actually the phenomenon of resonance. So what exactly is resonance? So that's what we'll discuss in today's lecture. Now, in the previous lectures, I discussed that most electrical and mechanical or any practical systems can be modeled as a set of linear differential equations. Okay. Now, we also studied how does systems behave when you apply different frequencies as inputs to that. Now, a system is said to be in resonance at a particular frequency, omega naught, here, written here. When you apply a frequency, a signal of frequency, omega naught, and only for that frequency, your system gives a very huge gain. Okay, for every other frequency, the system doesn't give a huge gain, but when you give one particular frequency omega naught, your system amplifies it significantly, or gives, I mean, it starts giving you a large output for this at the same frequency, then that system is said to be resonating at the frequency omega naught. Now, resonance is a phenomenon that we will commonly encounter in many electrical circuits, one of the famous ones being oscillators and LC circuit, okay, and even many RF circuits. Sometimes we exploit this phenomenon to get very high gain at certain frequencies, okay, and sometimes it's unwanted. Sometimes our systems might run into this phenomenon of resonance, like for example in this bridge, it was not supposed to be, it turned out that the bridge actually collapsed because of that. So here, let me take a brief moment to explain this. I mean, at that time, one of the theories of that was actually proposed in the early, this was around 1940s or sometime when the event happened. So wherein they assumed the vertical displacement of the bridge and the wind velocity. The wind velocity was an input. Wind is the input to the system, and the vertical displacement, or in fact even torsion, both were considered as the system variables. And the reason given at that time was the wind velocity had matched with the resonant frequency. When I say the frequency of the wind's velocity matched with the resonant frequency of the system started resonating. And so it started, it then, when I said system is in resonance, it's going to generate a large output at some particular frequency, okay, then it eventually collapsed. What that was the reason at that time, which was later proven to be wrong, but still in many control theory books this example is often given to illustrate the idea of resonance. Okay, so first we will come back to the electrical circuits. Now, one of the most popular circuits that we deal with is a parallel LC circuit, where you put connect an inductor and a capacitor in parallel together, two energy storing elements in parallel together, or a series LC circuit. Okay, a series LC circuit. Now both these circuits are said to be resonant circuits, in that, for example, the impedance of this circuit, if one tries to understand how does the impedance of this circuit behave, or even this circuit, I'm going to find the admittance, which is G of S, which is 1 by Z of S. Okay, I'll use Y, so which is admittance of this network, that is 1 by Z of S. If we try to plot it, we'll try to see how exactly will it look like. So for a parallel LC circuit, at we know that the inductor, I mean impedance of an inductor, will increase linearly with frequency, it is omega L, and for a capacitor it will decrease with frequency. As you increase the frequency, it's 1 by omega C. Now when you put two elements in parallel, the one with the lower impedance will dominate the overall impedance. So initially the circuit will behave like a purely inductive circuit, because the inductor impedance is very low. You can see that it's very low. I mean, let me just draw the capacitive impedance also on the same graph. So in this region, it's going to behave like an inductor, and so this will be an inductor. At high frequencies, it will behave like a capacitor. Okay, at high frequencies, the overall impedance should look something like this. So at low frequencies, it should be like an inductor, increasing linearly. At high frequencies, it should be like a capacitor. Okay, so in fact, when at low frequencies, when omega equal to 0, the impedance of an inductor is 0. So this network should behave like a short circuit. At high frequencies, again, when omega is infinity, capacitor will behave like a short circuit. So again, this network will behave like a short circuit. Now, if you look at the impedance of the inductance, it is actually j omega L. And the impedance of a capacitance is minus j by omega C. It's 1 by j omega C or minus j by omega C. Now, if you look at these two terms, this is positive. Complex. It's a purely imaginary term, but still it's positive. This term is actually negative. Now, there is a possibility. I mean, we discussed in one of the previous lectures that when you have two impedances in parallel, we can have this impedance blowing up or this impedance reaching a value of infinity if Z equals minus Z. If this value equals minus Z. So I'm simply going to equate J omega L equals or J omega L minus J by omega C. So, or rather, I'm going to equate the two impedances and find the value 1 by root LC. So at this omega, at this frequency, both the value of omega L is same. I mean, omega naught L equals 1 by omega naught C. So this impedance is also going to be same. This is going to be minus J by omega naught C, which is also equal to minus J omega naught L. Now, since the impedances are equal and opposite in sign, the net impedance, the parallel impedance, is going to be infinity. Okay, so this network actually has the impedance actually blows up to infinity at a frequency omega naught equals 1 by root LC. Okay, if you remember, I tried to compute poles in a very similar manner for a parallel RC circuit as well in one of the previous lectures. Okay, in one of the previous lectures, I tried to compute the pole of a simple parallel RC network or parallel RC network, and we just equated R equals minus 1 by SC, and we found S as minus 1 by RC. We said this network has a pole at, okay, this parallel circuit, RC circuit, has a pole at minus 1 by RC. But if I substitute S equal to J omega, I'm going to get an imaginary number. Okay, so what does this mean is, for if you apply a signal at this frequency, this impedance is actually not going to blow up to infinity, because there is this frequency at which it has, it's really going to blow up, is an imaginary number. So this is only for what we also saw, what happens when you have it, it behaves like a pole and all that we described, that the gain starts falling off or the impedance starts falling off after this frequency. But when you see this network in a parallel LC network, it is very different. You are actually getting, when you solve this equation, we got a finite frequency omega naught, which was exactly equal to, I mean, this was omega naught, which is 1 by root LC. At that point, the impedance was exactly equal to infinity. It was actually blowing up. Okay? So if you actually take an ideal inductor and ideal capacitor, put it in parallel together, the impedance will behave like an open circuit at omega naught equals 1 by root LC. That's a real frequency. Okay? So I've shown it here in a figure. So in this figure, if you can see here, I've just shown what I've described so far. So the impedance of an inductor of this parallel LC network can be written like this. And when omega equals 1 by root LC, this impedance term will blow up to infinity. So that's what is shown here. Okay? And that term is what we call as a resonant frequency. At the resonant frequency, the impedance of the inductance is J. It's actually J omega naught L. Okay, and since omega naught is 1 by root LC, I've substituted that here in this expression. You can see it here. In this expression, I've substituted here, and I get J root of L by C, and minus J root of L by C will be the capacitive impedance. At that frequency, I've written it as omega R here. It's omega naught. Okay, so this is the resonant frequency, the frequency at which the impedance blows up to infinity. So what do I mean by this is that, so if I take a So if I actually take a parallel, if I take a parallel LC circuit, and inject a current, say of frequency I naught sine omega naught t, this circuit in theory should give me an infinite output voltage. So that's what this means, and it will. I mean, if the inductor is perfectly ideal, we will later see what is the kind of waveform we will get, in some of the next lectures. You will actually, in theory, you should get a sinusoid of infinite amplitude across the LC circuit, parallel LC circuit. Okay, so here that corroborates what our definition of a reference resonance was. At only one frequency, the system is going to give you an infinite gain, a very very large gain. In this case, it happens to be infinity for a parallel LC circuit. Okay, so we have seen the frequency domain response of a parallel LC circuit. In a similar manner, here I have shown for a series LC circuit. Again, a series LC circuit, if you have an inductor and a capacitor, both of them are in series. At DC, capacitor will be an open circuit. When you have two elements in series, the one with the larger impedance will dominate the overall impedance. So at low frequencies, it will behave like a capacitor because that's going to have a very high impedance. At high frequencies, it's going to behave like an inductor. So we know capacitor is going to have an impedance like this. It's going to fall off as frequency at low frequencies. An inductor is going to increase linearly for high frequencies. Okay, somewhere this element transitions. So initially it behaves like a capacitor, and then it transitions into an inductor. Okay, and that transition actually takes place at the resonant frequency omega naught, which is equal to 1 by root LC. Now what happens at the resonant frequency is that here we have two elements with impedances Z and minus Z connected in series. So eventually they will cancel out both the impedances, and you will get a zero impedance. Okay, so the resonant, if I plot the impedance as a function of frequency, what's going to happen is that at DC it will be like a capacitor, will be infinity, it will be like an open circuit here, shown here. It will behave like an open circuit here. And at high frequencies, inductor will behave like an open circuit. So I'm going to have an impedance of infinity at both DC and infinite frequencies. But at omega equal to 1 by root LC, I'm going to get a zero impedance. Exactly, the impedance is going to become zero. Now if I plot the admittance, which is 1 by impedance, that's going to be zero at DC and zero at infinity, and it's going to blow up to infinity at omega naught, which is 1 by root LC. The impedance of an inductor is going to be j omega naught L, and capacitive impedance is minus j by omega naught C, which is also equal to minus j omega naught L. Okay, and this can be written as j root of L by C and minus j root of L upon C will be the capacitive and inductive impedances. Okay, so this is about the phenomenon of resonance. So similarly, in this circuit, if I actually feed a voltage input to this series LC circuit and try to measure the current, if I feed an input of value V naught, say cos omega naught t, so a sinusoid of frequency omega naught, if I feed it as an input to this system, then the current is going to blow up to infinity. So that's what this tells us, because current is simply V upon Z. So since Z of S has zero at omega naught, 1 by 0 would be infinity. Your current will blow up to infinity for this series LC circuit. Okay, again, this is it's already obvious from the result, but I'll just state this. So for example, in a series LC circuit, so when you take a series LC circuit or even a parallel LC circuit, so when first I'll take a parallel LC circuit, so I said for low frequencies it behaves like an inductor. So which means, if I'm applying a voltage input, the current we know for an inductor is j omega, V upon j omega. So we know the voltage is j omega L into I. So which means, if I draw a phasor diagram for this, if this is your voltage phasor, okay, the current phasor is going to be something like this. Your current will actually lag the voltage, so therefore your current phasor is going to be like this. So this is your current, it's going to lag it by pi by 2, 90 degrees. Now at high frequencies, what happens is that this circuit reduces to a pure capacitor. There, your current will be equal to J omega C into V, which means your current is going to lead the voltage. So for when I say high frequencies, for frequencies greater than omega naught, and this is for frequencies less than omega naught. What's going to happen is that your current waveform is going to lead the voltage waveform at high frequencies. So if you see this, there is a 180 degree phase shift for the current from low frequencies to high frequencies. So I haven't plotted the phase impedance, so I'll just the phase response of this impedance. Okay, so if I have a parallel LC network, we just only plotted the frequency, the magnitude response, and we said which was J omega L upon 1 minus omega square LC. Now this function, if I'm trying to plot this, the magnitude response would start at plus pi by 2, because current is going to lead. It's going to be plus pi by 2. Okay, current is going to lag, and so this is impedance. So I'm just directly plotting the phase response here of the impedance J of omega. So it will start from plus pi by 2. It will remain constant for omega much less than 1 by root LC or omega naught square. This term will approximately be J omega L. So if I plot it, the magnitude is always going to be omega L, but the phase is magnitude is going to be omega L, but the phase is going to be plus J, which is pi by 2. Now what happens at the resonant frequency, we will come to it later, but immediately when omega is greater than 1 by root LC, okay, for omega less than 1 by root LC, this term is always positive. 1 minus omega square LC is always positive, so the phase is always going to be plus pi by 2. For omega greater than 1 by root LC, this term 1 minus omega square LC is going to be less than 0. When that happens, it's your output is you're going to get a phase of which is going to be minus j omega l. Okay, I've ignored the term 1 minus omega square LC, but actually you will actually get since this term is going to be greater than 1, you will actually get omega square LC with a minus sign, so you will be getting minus J by omega C, which is true because we know that it's going to transition into a capacitor. Now here the phase of this impedance is minus pi by 2. Okay, so the impedance undergoes a 180 degree phase shift at the resonant frequency, right? Because before this it was positive and purely imaginary. After this it is negative and purely imaginary, the impedance. So there will be a sudden phase transition from plus pi by 2 to minus pi by 2 for a parallel LC network, and we can similarly show for a series as well, but I'm showing it for a parallel LC network. Okay, so this is all about the frequency response, and we also saw that both parallel LC and series LC resonate at the frequency 1 by root LC for this given network. We will later take up more complex networks and try to find the resonant frequencies of such for those systems. Okay, now I'll start talking about the energy stored. How do you go about analyzing parallel and series LC circuits for different inputs and initial conditions? So first I'll start with the example of a parallel LC circuit with an initial voltage of Vx stored across it, or V0. I'm going to use V0 as an initial voltage stored across this. Now what happens to this system? Now the moment there is the capacitor energy right now is half C V0 square. Now I've somehow instantly charged this capacitor. How do we charge it? We'll see that in the next classes. But now say somehow we could actually instantly charge it. So we have a stored energy of half C V0 square. Now we will try to find the current in the circuit, and also the what happens to the, and in the steady state how does the circuit behave. Now since we have separation of charges on both the plates of the capacitor, the inductor will now try to discharge the capacitor. Okay, so now current will start flowing from the capacitor into the inductor, and the charges will be deposited on the negative plate. And this charge transfer will keep taking place till all the charges have moved from the positive plate to the negative plate. At that point, we started from V0 for the capacitor, and eventually it will come to zero. Okay, now let's say we took a capacitor C with the value C and a connected resistor in parallel with it. Okay, it's very similar to that. We have a positive, deposited a voltage, some charge across the capacitor, which had a potential difference of V0 across it. What will happen is that the resistor is now going to move these charges from one plate of the capacitor to the other plate. And in the process, it's going to, capacitor voltage will eventually come to zero. And since it's a resistance, it offers resistance to the flow of current, there will be some power loss in the resistor, and it will dissipate away all the energy contained in the capacitor. But here, instead of a resistor, we have an inductor. As a current flows in an inductor will start storing energy. Okay? Now, the current through the inductor, you know, V is L di by dt, is nothing but 1 by L integral Vc of t dt. Okay? The current through this inductor is simply given by 1 by L integral Vc of t dt. So, as long as the voltage across the capacitor is positive, which is nothing but the voltage across the inductor as well. Voltage is positive, the current will keep on increasing. So when the voltage across the capacitor goes to zero, the current of the inductor will be peaking. That will be the maximum value. Now, all that energy in the capacitor, which was half CV naught square, has been fully transferred to the inductor. And this energy, that here I'll show it in a different color. So this is capacitor inductor energy. Okay. And now that's going to be stored as magnetic energy in the inductor. Now, since inductor has a finite current, inductor has some finite current across it, through it, flowing through it, it will continue flowing, the current will continue flowing through the capacitor in the opposite direction, in the same direction. So now, capacitor will be charged in the opposite direction. So your capacitor voltage will start going negative, because now the inductor is further charging it in the opposite direction. So the capacitor voltage will go negative. As the capacitor voltage goes negative, we know that the inductor current is going to reduce, and the inductor current is now going to come back to zero. At that point, your capacitor voltage would have reached a peak value in the opposite direction. Now, all the energy that was stored in the inductor, okay, when capacitor voltage was zero, all the energy was stored in the inductor. That energy is now fully transferred back to the capacitor, but the voltage is now in the opposite direction. So this way, we'll actually get a sinusoidal output across the LC tank. So we'd actually get something like this. So we'd get a sinusoidal, we are going to get a cos signal across the capacitor. And the current through the capacitor or the current through the inductor will be a sine wave. Because, as we explained, if one is at the maximum, the other has to be at zero. So keeping that in mind, you can actually draw this waveform. It will be 90 degrees out of phase. Okay, this will be the current through the inductor. Now we will try to give a more rigorous mathematical analysis for this. So I'll just take L and C. So if I'm going to assume initially we had a voltage V0 across it, and I said the voltage across the capacitor is going to be Vc of t, will be V0 cos omega naught t. And the voltage across the inductor is also same. Now I'll try to find the current through the inductor, which is nothing but in this direction. It's flowing in this direction into the inductor. That will be obtained, we can obtain by 1 by L integral V dt. So that will give me 1 by L V naught by L into omega naught into sine omega naught t. So integral of cos is sine, you get this. So I'll assume the initial current flowing through that was zero. So this will be the expression for it. So this is V naught upon omega naught L sine omega naught T. So this is the current flowing through the inductor. Now if I ask you to find the current flowing through the capacitor, it's going to be with a negative sign. So this will be minus V naught by omega naught L sine omega naught T. So you can very easily show that if you write KCL at this node, IC of T is in this direction. I've shown it like that. So voltage across both, it's a parallel LC circuit, so both the voltages across the capacitor and inductor are same. Now I'll try to find the power dissipated in the capacitor. So that will be nothing but the product of Vc of t into Ic of t. So that will be minus V naught square upon omega naught L into sine omega naught into cos omega naught. So I'll write it as sine 2 omega naught by 2 t by 2. Okay, so from this you are left with minus half v naught square. Now v naught, the resonant frequency, we said omega naught l will also be equal to 1 by omega naught c. Okay, so I'll write it as c v naught square into omega naught into sine 2 omega naught with a minus sign. And similarly, the voltage, the power dissipated across the inductor, you can simply take the product of voltage and current and get this value. You will actually get a similar expression, which will actually be half C V naught square plus half C V naught square into sine 2 omega naught t. So this is the power dissipated across the inductor and the capacitor. So if I try to plot this, you can see from this expression, sine 2 omega naught t is oscillating at twice the frequency of than omega naught. Okay, now this term, the inductor energy or power actually is with a negative sign. Now what does it mean in this graph when it's positive negative is that we first discussed that when the capacitor had a voltage V naught across it, the current was flowing away from the, I mean out of the capacitor terminal, right? So capacitor is actually delivering energy and inductor is actually absorbing energy. So therefore, when you look at the power dissipation across the capacitor, I think the pink one is actually the capacitor power. So this is PC of t, which is less than 0 initially. For the first till omega naught, it is less than 0. Okay. So I'll also plot the voltage waveform across the capacitor. The voltage waveform across the capacitor is, it peaks here, it then goes to 0 here. Okay. And then in another half cycle, it goes to, okay, a negative peak, and in the other half, other two half cycles, it's going to rise back to a peak value. Okay, so this, understand, this is omega naught. This overall cycle is 2 pi by omega naught, whereas here this is actually twice omega naught. This is at twice the frequency. So from this graph we can actually see the voltage is positive here, so capacitor is actually delivering power in this cycle, right? Current is flowing from the capacitor into the inductor. After that, in this cycle shown here, capacitor voltage is negative, and we discussed that inductor will have a peak current and inductor will start charging the capacitor in the opposite direction. So now inductor is delivering power, capacitor is absorbing power. Okay, but the net power dissipated is always zero. If I find the total power dissipated, it is always zero in the system. There is no power dissipation at all in the system. Okay, so it's just that one element is delivering power, the other element is absorbing power, and that should sound very intuitive, because I just have two impedances like this at the resonant frequency. I said the circuit reduces to just a parallel element of two elements, a parallel equivalent of two elements. So whatever be the voltage across this, okay, if plus Z is going to absorb current, minus Z, the impedance minus Z is going to deliver that current. Okay, so one element is going to absorb power, the other element is going to deliver power. Okay, interestingly, here for an for a capacitor and inductor, in one quarter cycle, here it's actually one quarter of a cycle. So since it is 2 omega naught, this is one half of 2 omega naught, so that will be one quarter of a, this is t by 4, where t is 2 pi by omega naught. In one quarter cycle, capacitor delivers power. In other quarter cycle, in this cycle, again t by 4, inductor delivers power. Okay, the who delivers power, it just keeps changing between the quarter cycles, but the total power lost is zero for the system. Okay, it keeps going back and forth between capacitor and inductor. So now we'll try to find the energy stored in the capacitor and the inductor. So to get the energy stored, we know the PC of t is minus half C V naught square omega naught sine 2 omega naught t. So I'll try to integrate power. Energy stored in the capacitor is simply integral of PC of t dt. So I'd actually get half C V naught square. If I integrate cos, I mean sine, you will get cos 2 omega naught t, okay, by 2 omega naught. plus there will be a constant of integration. Okay, so this is again 1 by 4, there is an omega naught here, 1 by 4 cv naught square cos 2 omega naught t plus k. Now we know that at t equal to 0, the energy of the capacitor was half cv naught square. That's where we started. So from that we can show the value of k is actually 1 by 4 cv naught square, and from this we can actually reduce this expression to 1 by 2 cv naught square into cos square omega naught t. Okay, and this should look obvious because I can write it as half c v naught cos omega naught t the whole square. That's your energy across the capacitor as a function of time, right? So we already said if I have a parallel LC circuit, the voltage across this is V naught, the capacitor is going, voltage across the capacitor, it's going to go from zero and all that. So we discussed the solution will be V naught cos omega naught t. In fact, we can mathematically find the solution for this. I'll probably show that the mathematical, using a simple second order differential equation, we can get this solution. I haven't done this here because I assume that you already know to do that. Okay, the solution can be shown to be V naught cos omega naught t. Okay, and since we know the voltage across the capacitor, half C into V naught square will give the energy across the capacitor. So similarly, the voltage and the energy dissipated or energy, energy stored in the inductor can be shown as half. So we'll have to integrate that. You can actually find the current. So now we know the voltage across the capacitor. So the current is simply V naught upon omega naught L into sine omega naught t. So that's your current. Okay, I already showed you how to find that. Okay, you can use c dv naught by dt, you will get this. Okay, so this is also equal to omega naught c into v naught into sine omega naught t. This is your current across the inductor. So I can simply write it as half l I square. So l into c omega naught the whole square into V naught square sine square omega naught t. Okay, so again we can do some very simple manipulations here using the results omega naught L equals 1 by omega naught C. We can again very easily show this is equal to half C V naught square sine square omega naught t. Okay, so now if you add the both inductor and capacitor energies, EC of t plus EL of t, that will exactly be equal to half CV naught square. At any given time, it's always constant. Okay? Because you get sine square plus cos square is 1, and you'd get that. So if you plot the energy of a capacitor, the energy stored in the capacitor, it will start from a peak value, which is half CV naught square, and it will go to 0 at 1 quarter cycle. We already saw these results. It will oscillate like this. And the energy stored in the inductor will start from 0. And it, see, here we have squared. This is sine square and cos square. It's always positive. It will go to peak when capacitor energy is 0 and so on. So this will be the graph for inductor energy, energy stored in the inductor. And the sum of the two, the sum of both the energies will always be constant. Okay? Sum of both the energies will always be constant, and that will be equal to, so if I plot the sum of the two energies here, it will always be constant, and that will be half C V naught square. Okay, so that is all about series LC and parallel LC circuits. I have discussed the frequency response, the energy stored, the power dissipated and absorbed in both the inductor and capacitor, and also the energy that is stored in a parallel LC circuit. Okay, the next lecture onwards we'll start taking different inputs and we'll study how does the series and parallel LC circuits behave. Here I've not gone in depth for a series LC circuit, but it's a very similar treatment. You'd get very very similar results. So in a series LC circuit, when there is no excitation, meaning I'm not applying any voltage input, so I'll have to short it. I'll assume that the initial current in the inductor is I naught, so the circuit will simply reduce to something like this. L and C, they both are in series. I'm just drawing it at this point. So this is V naught across the capacitor, V naught of VC of T is the voltage across the capacitor, and you are supplying the inductor. Is now initial current was flowing in this direction. Okay, inductor will now supply a current I naught. So here, if I ask you to plot for this, we can very easily show that the inductor current will be I naught cos omega naught t, and the inductor voltage, the voltage across the capacitor and the inductor. Once you know, you will have to see 1 by omega naught c I naught sine omega naught t. So this will be the current through the capacitor IC of t. So this is IL of t. Okay, I'm sorry, this is the voltage across the inductor or capacitor VC of t. Okay, so now you can see in the first quarter cycle, your inductor will be delivering power to the capacitor and capacitor will be absorbing the power. In the next quarter cycle, capacitor will be delivering power and inductor will be absorbing power. So the same thing follows. The only difference is we started with inductor providing for the initial energy here. Okay, that's half Li square. So again, we can very easily show all the same graphs. The energy of an inductor is half L I naught square cos square omega naught t. This will be your EC of EL of t, energy of an inductor. And energy of the capacitor EC of t will be half L I naught square sine square omega naught t. Okay, the sum of the two will always be constant. So this will be the energy across the capacitor, the pink one, and the energy across the inductor will be in the yellow one, and the sum will always be constant, and that will be equal to half L I naught square. Okay, and we can very easily show that in the first quarter cycle, inductor will be delivering power, and again you can take the product of voltage into current and show all those results. Okay, I'm not doing for that. We have done it extensively for parallel circuits. A similar analysis, we can very easily show this. So I'll stop at this point.